Hey everybody, thanks for being here. Today we're off the Oregon coast out of Garibaldi going after albacore tuna with live bait and jigs. Now if you want to learn how to catch more fish, stay tuned. I'm Justin Wolf and this is Angler West Television. Good day of fishing when you're using a crane to offload your fish.
Bucket number two for today's work.
We're in the small town of Garibaldi, Oregon, where after a pleasant night at the Garibaldi House, we're ready to head out of Garibaldi Marina to catch those albacore tuna with Dave Phillips, who's fishing with Jimmy Wu, Rick Hale, and Roy Marquis. The plan is to use a combination of live anchovies and jigs to load the boat with great-eating albacore. But first, we need our live bait.
All right.
With bait on board, we now need to run offshore to find that magical zone where warmer water temperatures and nutrient-rich currents come together to attract the fish.
It's a great thing to have live bait available in Garibaldi. We just left the harbor with two scoops of live anchovies, and we're headed about 50 miles west of port to go have a whole lot of fun. In Garibaldi, this year, for the first time, we have a steady supply of live anchovies. They're very important for albacore fishing. The port of Garibaldi and Jeff at Garibaldi Marina went to great effort to bring live anchovies to us here in Garibaldi, and we certainly love to fish with them. We use them together with all the other tackle that we use on board here, and these keep the anchovies nice and happy. This is a live bait tank with a bait pump that swirls the water around in there, and it keeps them from bumping against the side of the tank, so they're all happy and squiggly by the time we get out there on the fishing grounds so we can send them below the boat.
Garibaldi is a great crabbing area as well, so we might as well throw out some crab traps on the way out.
Now we're off. So we just dropped a couple of fish field crab traps in 75 feet of water off the tips, and we're headed out on our bearing to rock to the blue water break, and we hope we have a nice ride. The wind blew a little bit yesterday, but I'm thinking that it laid down long enough for us to have a nice smooth ride. So Jimmy's gonna jump on his bean bag and we'll all take a nap for a couple of hours.
Get ahead!
Got it.
Got chum ready? Baby, slow down. Let's just do it.
There's solid marks.
All right, shut the engine off. Let's make it a go.
Engine's off. Hit a solid tuna mark here at 60 feet. Little bait below it. These guys here are also tuna marks.
Solid at 60.
Yeah, baby. Okay.
Let's go.
All right, we rolled into a little pot of working birds. There were Arctic terns and a few shearwaters sitting on the water, and we stopped on top of this school and saw a few on the sounder, and all we need to do is hook up one or two, get some more chum in the water, get the school coming to the boat. We're gonna have to work at the end, and I'm not sure if this school is gonna come up yet. So we send these 112, 140, and 168 gram flat-sided jigs down below the boat where the fish are, and hopefully we can get school moving. Yeah, those birds are still working that spot.
I
Hook him up, Roy.
Jump him up. Hey, Sean.
Okay. More chum.
You got color.
Give me a net. You tell us when you're ready. He's under the boat. Here you go, buddy. It's all yours.
Okay, I'm ready for a net.
Okay. Rick? That's a peanut. Woo! Hey, tiny. Tiny little baby. Huh.
Welcome back to the Albacore Tuna Fishing Grounds off the Oregon coast. I'm Justin Wolf. We're about 50 miles offshore using a combination of live bait and iron. And early on, it looks like the tuna are wanting the jigs.
Pink and blue, is that what you got hit on, bud? Okay.
I was jigging faster, wasn't getting bit.
Slow retrieve.
I slowed down the action a little and got bit right
slow
off the
down.
Bat.
Awesome.
Under the boat here.
Hey, Jimmy, give me your hand a second.
Oh, come here, fish.
I want to put my thumb.
Not enough strike.
I'm going to get hot.
Ready for a net right there? We like 25 pounders. That one is
maybe six
to 8 pounds at most. Huh? Maybe, are they bigger than that on your boat?
Beautiful specimen, but a little bit small on size. We like them about 20 pounds bigger than that.
Nice fish, but hey, we're gonna find a bigger school.
I'm ready for a net.
Okay. Somebody ready over there? No, just me.
Hold on.
Roy, there you go, bud. Oops.
So I'm collar hooking this anchovy. You just go in right behind the gill plate and out, just like that. Get her out of here, throw her in a freeze pool, get it away from the boat a little bit. Hopefully she swims down instead of out, because the seagulls like to eat them. There's the seagull.
We had nothing.
Keep an eye on that corner rod.
Boy, this handle is a little tape. I can't see him in that sun.
There you go.
Okay, I got him. Thank you.
Yeah. I think I'm gonna move this one around the back corner. Coming around, guys. What I was trying to do is, as we work this school up, trying to get three or four on at once and keep two or three on in the back of the boat, like that one in the corner over there. Just set them in the rod holder and they serve as decoys, and the rest of the school will come up and eat the chum, eat the live bait, and hopefully we can really light things up.
Well, he was about 10 feet deep when I hooked him, but he's gone now.
I'm on.
Rick's on. Live bait's working out behind the boat too. So what we do is we keep a steady stream of chum. We fling it out ahead of the boat, so the chum.
Oh, under.
Heads up. So the fish will follow the chum slick right down and underneath the strike zone, which is 50 feet below the back of the boat. Sometimes we get away with four anglers. Sometimes we get away with three. Today it's working okay. We got not too big of a mess rolling. As soon as we hook six, then it'll be a mess.
Roy, you're in that man right
Okay, we got a problem going here.
Nope, forget it, Roy.
Hey, can somebody run up to the bow for me? Yeah, this fish went all the way around.
Is that net? Ready? Are you ready there, Boo?
Yep.
Okay, I'm gonna circle one more time.
It's so slippery.
I know, I brought some friction tape for it.
Got it?
We dropped these butterfly jigs down below the boat, 50, 60, 70, or 80 feet, and stop the spool and then slowly pump and crank, or we quickly pump and crank to find what action that the fish want. And as you're moving it up and down through the water column,
Up and over. I go around.
I'm under you, buddy.
There we go.
Yeah.
There we are. Good for now.
Anyway, so the vertical jigging game is all between 10 feet below the boat and maybe 150 feet below the boat. And use these flat side jigs, cast them a little ways ahead, let them drift down below the boat. We use about 15 to 20 feet of 30 or 40 pound fluorocarbon leader tied to the main line, which is 50 pound braid. And try to feel the jig as it's going down through the water column. Move it up, move it down, flutter it a little bit. That's how you get bit. And with the bait working up near the surface and the iron jigs working down deep, it draws the spool continually up and down through the water column. And we work together with all the bait. Iron below, bait on top.
Yeah, I hope you're enjoying today's episode from the Oregon coast, where we're catching albacore, some of them on live anchovies, but most of them on jigs similar to these fish field butterfly jigs rigged at either one or two assist hooks. Now, a great rod for this type of fishing is the Lamaglass TFX 7030C. It's got plenty of backbone, it could throw a jig a mile. Plus, it's 7 feet long, which will help you deal with those unruly fish. Now, for line, you might spool up with the P-Line TCB X-Braid with P-Line 30-pound CFX fluorocarbon on top. Now, let's go back and catch some more albacore.
Always checking to see if there's fish under the fish finder. If there are, we still have a chance to catch them. It looks like there are some.
Anybody been bit on iron for a while?
No.
I haven't.
Start looking for the next school.
Yep.
Because they're starting to get sparse.
So what we do is every fish that comes in gets bled and chilled in the bleed tank. It provides for a better quality product when we're taking it home to our families. Almost sushi grade is generally what we come up with.
So we carry lots of ice on this boat, maybe up to 600 pounds every trip out here. We start with enough ice to chill the fish in the bleed tank, get that nice and cold. So I'm transferring ice back to the bleed tank. As soon as those fish are cooled down enough, we'll start transferring them under floor, packing them thick in ice. Stern or bow? Okay.
Watch, see who's up and down where. It's kind of a ballet. That fish is out. You are under and over. Under and over.
Nice job.
I'm still underneath the boat.
Still underneath?
Yep. No, I'm good. I'm out.
You're good now. Okay.
Don't worry, guys.
Sorry.
Albacore tuna like to do circles after their initial run or two. They'll start to circle down deep. That's what we're trying to manage. When we get a lot of fish, they'll just start circling down below the boat. So we got to manage where everybody's at and try and keep them on their circle. This year we started netting the fish. The albacore aren't quite like salmon. They don't swim in a
quite as erratic
pattern as the salmon do. So we can just kind of direct them into the net and they come straight in. So
okay, baby.
There's one back here in the rod This one's a little bit better fish.
Oh, that's a nice fish.
Oh, shoot.
That was a nice fish.
That's just part of the deal sometimes.
Yeah,
we hook a lot and we lose a lot.
That one off of that one.
See? Fresh fish right after we lost one.
Finally took, huh?
That's okay, Rick. You just pulled the hook.
Finally took.
Still hanging over here. Couple fish on this side. Jimmy, are you on?
Well, we thought we were going to leave because we weren't sure we could keep the fish with us. Apparently there's enough of them following the boat along, sniffing that chum slick. Well, we can keep them rolling. Retie job by Jimmy Woo. I got mine all chafed too.
So some of the tools I like to use while we're bait fishing like this and iron fishing is a P-line pliers, snips, and then a knife, and then a towel. That way you don't have to be looking for all the tools. You have them readily at your hands. Speed's the key here. So once the bite starts dying down, we're gonna start looking for another pot of birds that are working some bait. Find a new hot school of fish that are a little more receptive.
Right towards that, just ahead of that boat at 5 o'clock.
What, 5 o'clock?
Get to the left of the boat at 5.
How far?
300 yards.
All right. Let's get him ready.
This one. They're peddling it in birds.
Okay, boat's off.
Time for some fish transfer while we move.
Boat's off, we're sliding in. Jimmy's on.
We're about 50 miles off the Oregon coast.
Jimmy's on.
In early September, a time when the albacore.
Fish on.
Oh, he's off.
Tend to feed near the surface, which is a great setup for fishing, as long as you can stay on top of the schools of feeding albacore.
Oh, there we go. Right under the boat, boys. Rick's on.
He's got five on.
He's gotta go. He's gotta go, he's gotta go.
I make it six on.
Yeah, I think you're inside of me.
I am.
Okay, let me.
I'm on the other side of the boat.
All right.
Oh. Ready for a net.
You got it, Jimmy? Awesome.
Yeah.
Rick, this one's got to go.
Tighten that up a little?
No, loosen it up a little bit.
Go tighten them up. It's about time.
I don't know, 15, 18 fish, and now just had a few.
We're just chasing them back and forth. There's the next boil, we've got to roll. All right, this time of year, in mid to late September, trolling is essentially a waste of time. So when the fish are up on the surface like this, showing themselves, birds are crashing, we just bounce back and forth from boil to boil, cast into a boil, hook up a fish or two, chum, try to bring that school to the boat. Once the bite goes down, we do it again, rinse and retrieve a whole bunch of times. The problem is, this time of year, if you were to troll continuously all day, you might get one or two, maybe three bites, and that's just not productive as far as I'm concerned. So we use all this casting and jigging and bait gear, and fish are already up on the surface. They're there for the take.
I got a short reach.
Okay, here you go. Slack.
I could have maybe gaffed him.
Yep.
recently we were converted to using a net on board because it makes a little less net mess here, if you kind of believe that. Gaffs poke holes in fish in places where you really don't want the holes, namely in the loins. So we just try to net every fish we can. They come over the rail and they're nice and pretty.
Okay, I'm on the net. Got a net ready.
Fish on again. There we go. Coming around. Fresh one. Thank you. Fishing again, baby.
Come on.
Three drops and 60 feet again. Just can't quit.
We've ended up catching 64 fish today, and the fish field crab pots didn't let us down either. Now you talk about a great dinner. Now if you need a place to stay in Garibaldi, the Garibaldi House across from the marina is just great. They've got breakfast ready to go for fishermen in the morning, plus that box lunch they offer is definitely a go. Hey, thanks for watching today's episode. You know, without the support of the sponsors, the show would not be possible. So please thank them when you can. Now get out there and do some great fishing.